TikTok. It's not real. Oh, there's a room. Still in frame. Still in frame. Ooh. So hello, beautiful, powerful, sexy, wonderful, kind, strong, intelligent people. Welcome to my channel. This channel has been a long, long. It's been a long time coming. But I know change gonna come. Ooh. Did you hear? Expect more madness like this on this channel. I said, let me just challenge myself to start this YouTube channel because I've been talking. My mouth has been moving, yapping like a rat for too long and that can't run no more. You know, they're wasted. You know, you got to talk to yourself in the mirror like, yo, my G, what really a guan right now. On this channel, I want to talk about a lot of things. I want to take you to a lot of places. Then, of course, I want to do some makeup, some fashion, some vlogs, some conversations with friends. And the fun bit that I really can't wait for is the story times. Guys, I've got some stories to tell you, okay? And hopefully, you know, as I grow on my journey, you can grow on yours also. This video is a tribute, but it's also the first video in a series of videos that I wanted to make when I initially set out to start this YouTube channel in 2021. My career was just taking off. I was stable for the first time after a period of homelessness, a mental breakdown and just struggling financially. So I didn't know what was coming. This was before Beckham's Finest. This is obviously before all of the amazing things that I accomplished last year. And as you watch the video, you can see how pumped and excited I am to be in a good place, to be able to go back to grandma's and tell this beautiful story. I do feel the video is a little bit incomplete, and that's just because, of course, I lost my grandma, may she rest in peace. I lost her and wanted to sort of do like a part two, ask more questions because I discovered a bit more about myself, but it's all good. It's all good. We give thanks for what we've got. I hope you enjoy the next 30 or 40 minutes and I will see you on the other side. So welcome to King's Cross Station. This station is my favourite station in London because it is the station that takes me home. My mum came here in 1993 to embark on a journey I'm sure she never thought she'd ever go on, and that is what we're going to do today. All the way from London, we're going to go up to Doncaster, and from Doncaster we will change and go to Haybrough, where Grandma will be waiting for me. Okay, so we are just arriving at Doncaster. Doncaster has similarly, just like King's Cross, been a huge part of my upbringing because this is where most of the trains would stop and then would change and head towards the village, the countryside. So lots of good memories here, but I'm going to focus on finding a toilet. Right behind me is the train that's taking me to Grandma. So excited. So I am currently on my way to Haybrough station and I'm very excited. I wanted to answer a few of your questions regarding my upbringing as a child in care, as well as just, you know, about the countryside. So the first thing is, my mother called her friend, who called someone up north, who called my grandma, who said yes. She was meant to come and visit me and pick me up when I was 2 years old. Those 2 years turned into 12. There was something beautiful that happened. A pure, genuine, life-changing, deep-rooting love that my grandma showed me and shared with me. Regardless of the colors of our skin, that woman loved me and I loved her back. And I'm very grateful for that. I'm very blessed. And I know that not a lot of people were able to experience that in their farming homes. I'm recording a video for YouTube.
Are you a YouTuber?
This is going to be my first video about where I come from.
Where do you come from?
Well, physically or heritage, my parents are Nigerian. But,
I could have guessed that.
but my upbringing was in Ulceby, Grimsby, Immingham.
Oh yeah, yeah, I know that area.
So Ulceby is an even smaller village, and I lived there for 12 years.
But that was boring, wasn't it?
It was all I knew. So in hindsight, yes, it was boring, but at the time, I don't think I felt any different to anyone on this train.
Oh, yeah.
But of course, I knew I was different, so I had a mental process to go through. A lot of people ask questions about what it was like growing up north. Like I just said to this gentleman, because it was all that I knew, I didn't know how strange it was until I moved to London and started to see people the same colour as me, the wider nose like me, the darker gums like me and things like that, the darker joints and the knuckles and the elbows and the knees. So I remember experiencing just quite a bit of confusion. Of course, Grandma did her best to accommodate some of those anxieties, but as a Caucasian lady herself, what more could she do, you know? When I went to school, although people were welcoming on the surface, I think deep down we were all thinking, what the fuck is she doing here?
Because I was fucking confused as well.
We're almost at Scunthorpe, if anyone remembers that Tiny Temple song. I've been to Bantam, but I never been to Scunthorpe.
I live in Scunthorpe. High five.
So when that song came out, when he said Scunthorpe, I was screaming to everyone in Peckham, like, they put Scunthorpe on the map, yeah! You know, really, really screaming and so excited and elated that where I was from was recognised. Once I came to London, I realised how tiny Ulceby, Immingham, Scunthorpe, Barton, Grimsby, Cleethorpes are.
The people there, talk to the people there, what do you want to say?
What's your name?
Joe.
Hello, I just met Joe on the train. She's a wonderful, beautiful woman. Had a few things in common with foster care and growing up.
Yeah.
Growing up in poverty, and I like and I respect what she does, and I hope she goes a long way in life.
I'm going to take you around the village and tell you a few more things when I get there, but I'm just going to relax and get excited to see her.
We're together!
Short drive from Haybrook into Ulceby. I'm so excited for you to see this. So guys, welcome to Ulceby. Just there is my grandma's house where I lived for 12 whole years. 12 long years, 12 great years, 12 difficult years. Don't make a joke about 12 years, a struggle. 12 years, a struggle, okay? I gotta start this again. All right, cool. My experience inside that house was nothing short of amazing and life-changing. There was lots of encouragement. One of the questions that I received was, you know, who taught you to be confident? Who taught you to embrace this confidence? And it's 100% my grandma. You know, she's from saying things to me like, you know, one day, sweetheart, your name's gonna be up in lights. From saying things like that to taking me to the best costume shop in the area to make sure I look the best in my year five play. And I will always love and treasure those memories. I played here, I cycled up and down here, I got in trouble. To my right, the house that I'm standing beside, we used to break into the back garden and steal gooseberries. Such a different life. Those were the tropical fruits that grew in this area. I'm gonna take you guys around the village as best as I can, but but this is home base. This is where it all began for me. This is where it all started. And I'm so grateful just to be able to bring you back here, to show you a little bit of my world and for you to get to know me a little bit better. So come with me. Oh, and before I go on, that right there is the tree that I used to play in. I think I might try and climb it.
I love it.
What did you then? I roll past us like, that's our Josie.
Oh, yeah.
Not from round here, out like you guys. If anybody bothers here, you'll have some trouble.
Definitely. Oh, my God. So I'm just making a video. I wanted to make a YouTube video.
You're streamer now.
Oh, God. Right, let me take it out of the tripod. Okay, is it recording? So, this is the awkward angle, but many times I climbed this tree, I didn't make it much higher than this, you know. This is where I laughed, this is where I joked, and this is where I spent a lot of my time climbing this tree and living my best life as a country girl, raised up in the country. Now, cue the awkward jump out of the tree. So let's go inside and let's meet Grandma and have a chat with her. Hi, Grandma.
Hi.
Thank you so much for doing this for me.
Okay.
So, everyone, this is my grandma, the love of my life, the reason why there is still air in my lungs today. And I came here in 1993. The arrangement was £20 a month to look after me. And it was only meant to be for 2 years. Those 2 years turned into 12, and those 12, I guess, in terms of love, turned into a lifetime. But before we talk about or go into more detail of my story, Grandma, what? Well, first of all, hi.
Hi.
Oh, hi.
I'm nervous. I don't like doing this.
It's okay. You don't know, yeah, the amount of love and support that is on the other side of that camera, the amount of people who know about me and know my story and stuff. And I just felt like it wouldn't be right for me to start my journey on YouTube without honoring my origin. You know, you gotta honor your roots and stuff like that. Mine's a little bit unconventional, but here we are. So what got you into fostering? What made you want to start fostering?
Well, because I was one, the eldest of 13 children.
Yeah.
And then all I wanted to do was get married and have loads of children. I've had five, unfortunately I lost two,
yeah.
And I couldn't stop. I had to, so I enrolled with social services, and it's not like school, you just go to meetings and you gain extra experience from experienced foster carers.
Okay.
And but I used all my years of bringing my own children up and everything, and what I'd learned from my mum.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And I just went on from there, and I accepted any kind of child, because to start with it was white children, and a lot of the children were sexually abused and battered,
yeah.
And whatever.
Yeah.
And then my friend, she was fostering Nigerian children,
uh-huh.
And one of the ladies that got in touch with her, Irene was full at the time, she passed my number on. Your mum phoned and made arrangements to come down to see me.
Uh-huh.
And the rest is history. As I say, we didn't get on. I mean, I don't think we liked each other. But she gave me, you know, instructions what to food now, because I'd never done that before. Even Irene didn't. But I tried to do what your mum asked me to do.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Plaiting hair, some food. But I had to blend our food in with yours, because
yeah.
I had other children, foster children.
Yeah, yeah. How many foster children? How many children have you fostered, approximately?
Oh, I don't know, over 100, I think.
Over 100.
Yeah.
Through this door.
Through this door. Yeah.
And have you always lived here and fostered?
Estate. Yeah. We had loads of children there, and it was hard to start with, but you learn to let go, whether the Nigerian children, Ghana, whatever they are, or white children, they come to you and all they want is love and guidance. I mean, a lot of them was newborn babies.
Yeah.
And it took 2 years for them to leave. But in that time, you grow very close to them. And I'm still close to a lot of my foster
children.
Yeah.
So many kids came in and out of this home, but what was it like holding me?
We don't know. This
arms.
Skinny little thing come with really tight, like braid things in.
Yeah, yeah.
And earrings in, and he was only 4 months old.
Wow.
And he was that skinny. He was like, oh, it was awful. Anyway, I don't know. Between me and my son, who was a registered foster carer anyway, we just couldn't stop holding you. Yeah, David was registered as well.
Oh, I didn't know that. We shared it.
And he used to love taking the care of the babies and the toddlers and that.
Oh.
And recreating games and the outside.
Yeah.
And but no, when we got you, I don't know, we've had some beautiful children. They were all beautiful. But for, as David's always said, we don't know what it was. But as soon as we held you, that was it. We didn't want to let you go.
Oh.
But it was lovely for many years until then your mum started taking you home.
Yeah.
And it was different when you came back for a while. But, we absolutely... Well, we ruined them all anyway, but that little bit extra special went your way.
Yeah. Oh, I remember being so spoiled by you guys. So spoiled. I was saying to Uncle David, do you remember when I used to write everything that I wanted in the Argos catalogue?
Yeah.
And just be like, here, this is what I want
for
Christmas.
And he got
it. And I got it all. I got everything. Every single year.
Yeah.
I got exactly what I wanted for Christmas, which is why I always say, even though I've not had much in my life, I've never, ever once gone without, and I'm so grateful for that. What was I like as a child? Was I a good child? Was I naughty?
Oh, no. Very rarely any of my kids was naughty. They'd only maybe try it once, and then a few words from me or David, and that was it. There was two on tent in exploring the toys and everything, and we used to spend a lot of time doing things with you.
Yeah.
We used to put tapes on and sing nursery rhymes. We used to hold little tea parties and stuff like that. And even if a child just sitting up or anything, clapping their hands and everything,
mm-hmm.
probably no idea what we're talking about. No, you were always very good. I mean, you had your moments. All kids do. If you was laughing and that all the time, there'd be something wrong with you.
Yeah.
But of course you'd have these times when you're a little bit off, like, you know, but you cope with it, you know. Yeah. It's not something, you don't shout and scream at them and stuff like that. I was told to sit you on the stairs, bottom of the stairs, if you was naughty. I said, no, I ain't doing that.
Something that's always gone around my head, and I think from a place of pain, was, did my mum just throw me at you? Did she see?
Oh, no, no.
Did she cry? Did she run?
No,
did
she didn't cry, nothing. There was never any tears from your mum. She, every time she come down to see you, she was complaining about your clothes. The diet I was giving you, it still wasn't right. No matter what I did, was not right. And I said, well, you'll have to write it down what you want. She says, no, I've told you what you want. And I said, oh, well, that's up to me then. And that's what I did. I just buried my way through. I mean, it's a learning experience for me.
Because white children,
I don't mean the skin colour, but it's so different the way they behave and the way you do things for them compared to what we deal with you.
Of course. Yeah. No, it was different. I think, I don't remember being made to feel different, but I do remember being different, obviously, because of what was around me, but I don't ever...
No,
remember,
but you see, all the children, whether it was Nigerian or white, they never wanted to leave us. Then that's when the tears died. The little kids didn't want to go.
Yeah.
If we had, even when I got newborn babies straight from the maternity home, they fretted, they cried, because they're going somewhere new.
Yeah.
And it's not very nice, but there's nothing I could do about it. But what I used to do is, I suggested to Margaret, my link worker, I said, if it's all possible, when I know a child's going, I said, I do it with Nigerian or whatever race I get, I said, I'll try to arrange for another one to come in, because that way it doesn't hurt so much. It hurts, yeah, which I shed at night when the veins are straight on that. But I said, and she, that's what she used to do. She was marvellous. Mm. And she accepted what I was doing, because in that time when I did it, they didn't like white people fostering black children. Mm-hmm. But she encouraged it. And it was lovely, because it's just that, as I said to her, I think it's very important that white children and black children, or whatever race it is, they mix, because they've got to do when they get out in the world and go to school and everything. But you see, a lot of people looked at you a bit odd if you had a black child.
After being here for about 2 or 3 years and this financial contract that didn't really exist coming to an end, the money stopped. And grandma kept me for another 8, 9 years. I can't do the maths. Why? Why did you keep me when the money stopped?
Well, why not? I mean, money didn't come into it. Yeah, fair enough, it was only 20 quid. And I used to say to Irene, it's not enough, really. I mean, we never got a lot for social services, but it's not about the money. I mean, I can remember David saying, when the money stopped, I said, oh, we ain't got the money again. Oh, it don't matter, we'll muddle through, and we did. The money didn't come into it. I mean, it don't matter what we spent on any of you children, not just you, but any of the others.
Yeah.
The money didn't come into it.
So, very quickly, this is going to be a short one. Uncle David doesn't want to be on camera for too long, but I do just want to say, this man is like my father, looked after me, raised me, took me to play school.
I bought all your dresses.
He bought me dresses. He went to, Grandma was said in the interview before.
I just went around the shop picking up everything I saw and I said, I love these.
Love. Isn't that love? Uncle David, what was it like holding me in your arms?
No, that was because I was shoplifting.
Oh my God. Do you love me? Are you proud of me?
I am, darling. Especially a front page of a magazine.
The bed I have right now, you bought it for me.
A freezer as well.
And he bought my freezer. Thanks for reminding us.
And I bought a load of bedding.
And he's bought me a shit ton of bedding, actually.
Very nice bedding, though. And the kettle and the
toaster.
And the kettle
and the toaster and the microwave. Was the microwave you or was it Grandma?
I can't remember.
Well, they're all Russell Hobbs, very fancy stuff. If you guys want to know why I'm bougie, why my chest is high, why I like to live a certain luxurious life, this guy right here. I love you, Uncle David. I don't remember this, but this is actually in London. So I have met my biological mother. Well, I've lived with her. And then this is me and my best friend at the time. Oh my God, I had a busted poster. A little bit. Ooh. Yes, this might work.
How much is that going to cost you then, Jobby Nails?
Oh my God. Like £20? So I could actually, so like a string. Or maybe if I did this, oh, if I do this, I could, yeah, oh my God. And then my hands are in it and I don't think you can, oh, this is gonna work. So I'm gonna walk up and down. You can see, right? I'm making a little documentary, this works! Oh, such a good idea. Okay. So I have adjusted this correctly. Therefore, I can continue filming. So I've left Grandma's house literally about 30 seconds ago, and no sooner than another 30 seconds and I will be at the center of the village, and it will probably take me another minute to walk to the other side of the village. That's what we're working with here. But I'm not yet in the center of Ulceby. I'm just very close. My tripod is strapped to my chest. And I'm gonna answer some of your questions. So, what was the first question? Behind me there are the stables. I don't know if you can see, but just over there are the stables where I used to chill. So my upbringing here was pretty normal in the sense that I didn't know anything else. You know, I wasn't raised in London and then moved here. This was all I ever knew.
So it didn't really occur to me that I was different until I started to interact with other children outside of the home, which is basically, you know, parenting 101. And whilst I was at preschool, nursery, whatever it's called, I had a fight over a sand pit. And although sand was thrown in my eyes and my hair, I was told not to come back to school for about 2 or 3 weeks. And grandma, I remember grandma being absolutely fucking livid about it, but I didn't understand. And I remember her saying something like, it's because you're black. And I just thought, wait, what? Like, black people are really treated differently out here in these streets? And it was from that point on, I was what, maybe 4 or 5, that my differences started to show, I guess, and started to affect me. So one of the questions that I asked my grandma was, why are my hands this color? Does this mean that my mum is black and my dad is white? You know, I really didn't understand and didn't have any representation. So that affected me. And then the bullying began again. And then it turned into, Josie, why is your hair like that? Josie, why is your skin grey? You know, I wasn't aware of like moisturising. So I didn't know how to cream my hands all the time. So, or questions like, why does your hair cry? I had afro texture hair. And so, you know, I didn't know how to take care of it. So when it would get wet or something, I didn't know what was going on. I didn't know you're supposed to protect your hair, or, you know, things like that just didn't come naturally to me. So I really struggled with that. Also, just on the left, wait, no, you're watching the video. just over here on the right, is a house that I used to go to all the time. Her name was Steph, but I think she since moved from here, just behind me here. Big up Steph if you're watching this, or wherever you are in the world. And school was a really difficult place, you know. I mean, everyone tried their best to make me feel okay. Everyone tried their best to just, I don't know, make it okay. But it felt so hard and so difficult because everyone comes to school and gets picked up by their mum, but I get picked up by a white lady. That doesn't make any sense, does it? You know, when's my mum gonna come and get me? And whilst I was living in grandma's house, kids were being put up for adoption because she was a foster carer as well. And it was kind of like, well, when's my turn gonna be to be adopted? Why hasn't no one chosen me yet, you know? We're just in the center of the village and I want to get some clips, and we're going to walk up to the school and we'll continue this conversation there. So right here is one of the only shops that the village used to have. It's now shut down and been moved up to the top of the hill behind us. But I wanted to show you. Just going to let that car go by. As over here, right there, is the bus stop for the only bus that comes to this village. Once a day, I believe. It might be twice now. But if we turn completely at the top of the hill, just there, we're going to head towards it in a moment, is the co-op. So the village has been invested in. Places are getting bigger and more heavily populated, as is this village. And we've got all lots more people in the village. So the co-op's been put up there. I don't know the depths. I don't live here anymore. But let's go up. And coming up, we've got our only chip shop. Oi, it's a Chinese as well. So behind me is the village's local Chinese, but above there is the house where I spent a lot of my time in year 5 and year 6, the last 2 years of primary school. My best friend lived here and we got on because she was Asian and I was African. We were different together. It was really difficult and sometimes, quite often, felt really lonely, but having this other family here was really, really helpful to my self-esteem and just how I interact with the world and the relationships that I built. I really latched on to the person and their family that lived here because it just felt nice to not be the only different one, you know? And we really bonded over that. And if they are watching this video or their family, hi, I love you and thank you.
So we're now at the top of the village. Just behind me at the end of this road is the co-op that I was talking about. And on the other side, where we're actually going to, behind me now is my primary school. And further back is the field where I used to play in, have fun in, and run around in with one of my friends, Jess. We're actually about to go past their house, but I don't think she lives there, nor do her family. To your left, my right, we've got Ulceby St. Nicholas Church, where I believe I used to want to get married. And sadly, where my grandma will be buried. But we ain't got to think about that for now. I'm really excited. Guys, it's different, it's changed. So we're going past my best friend's house now, but like I said, I don't know if they still live there, so I'm not gonna bother embarrassing myself. But this that I'm about to show you used to be a wasteland. This used to be nothing. Wait a minute. Okay, so I did all my cycling lessons here. Grandma taught me how to ride a bike here for the first time, down this very pathway. I'm not sure if you can see it, but down that path, Grandma eventually let go of the bike and I learned I was cycling by myself with no stabilizers. Now coming up, there used to be nothing here. No, guys, it's different. It's different, it's different, it's different. It's different now. It's so different. This never used to be here. This never used to be here. It was a wasteland. It was a wasteland. Now there's a fancy house with a driveway. Oh my days, this used to be a rat infested barn, brother. Jeez, go on, Ulceby and Matt with the upgrade. This is crazy. Okay, so we're here. We're at my primary school. Up here, there used to be barns full of rats where we'd go and play in there. And now, you know, it's all done up. It's all pretty and nice. But here's my primary school. This is my primary school. I can't believe it. I'm so happy to be here. I will never, oh, so many memories of this place. So first of all, my best friend's house that was there, I'd always make her late to school. Shit, man, it was in me from young. I'd always make her late to school. Why? Because I don't want to chill at her house and do silly stuff. But we'd have to get to school on time. And it was just easy because it was next to the house. I can't get over how much this has changed. I can't get over that. I mean, I love it. I love it for the village. But it's so different. Anyway, so this is my primary school. Welcome to Ulceby St. Nicholas. I was here 1997, all the way to 2002. My goodness gracious me. And so just there, behind me there, that's the preschool, the nursery that I went to. I can still remember the smell. I can't describe it to you, but I still remember the smell. I don't remember the smell of the school, but I remember Miss Johnson, Mr. Wardley, Mr. Matthews, Mrs. Ling, who went to Australia and got married, right? Miss Crosswave, Miss Bornbar, Mrs. Stockard, Stockhart, or something like that. Just behind this building here is all field. It's complete field. And I remember just there, just there, in there, we took our year four, year five school pictures. I just remember the, I can remember the memory of it. It was a good day, you know. I don't think my hair was perfect how I wanted it, but it was a good day. It was a good memory.
Guys, we're just gonna do it. Guys, this is my friend. This is my friend from primary school. Jess, camera, Jess. Everyone wave. I know you're sitting at home watching this, but wave anyway. I was here, Jess was close to me, and so I came and I knocked on her door, and I wasn't sure she was gonna be in, but the someone was walking to the door, and I was like, oh my God, hi. Hi, it's me. And then Jess knew it was me, and then we hugged, and it was great. We went out, and we played, and we cycled. And we did things, and I ran from her dog, and we got chips, and then there was so much gravy, and all these things happened, and I'm so happy. I'm so happy that I'm having this moment.
Here I am at at the edge of the village. Literally right behind me is nothing but field, and if you could listen carefully or see more clearer, you'd see that we've got the motorway at the end of like two or three of these fields in a row. And that's just how rural, how countryside this is. I'm standing here on a track, you know, a dirt track that leads down to the chalk quarry. And I used to come down here a lot with friends, but sometimes when they weren't able to play out, I'd come down here by myself. And whilst I was by myself, I was either maybe going through like some emotional turmoil, or I'd start to ponder and wonder what would happen if I just took that motorway and walked all the way to London. What happens when it's time for me to go and live back with my mum? Will that time ever come? And it used to almost kind of haunt me, I'd say, and I really battled with my thoughts and my emotions and my feelings as a child. So to come back here now and done that inner work, the shadow work, the therapy, the psychology, whatever you want to call it, having done that work and coming back here, I feel so whole, and it feels good to feel whole. I always felt broken. I always felt like a part of me was missing, or like I was only a small part in someone else's story. But now, obviously, we've got that main character energy, you know, like that. Whoa, I'm the main character in my motherfucking story. Crunk it out, bitch. Anyway. It's the hard part.
I know, but
saying goodbye to my babe. I do, Grandma.
Right.
I love you so much.
Bye bye. Thank you for coming down, darling.
There she is, my babes. Look at her. My beautiful babes. Hi, Grandma. Hi, Grandma, it's me. Oh, Hi, Grandma.
I'm coming. Well, when you said you was on a train, I thought you was calling me.
Happy birthday, my babes. I am the surprise. I am the gift. Hi, everyone. Okay, Grandma, don't be angry, but I'm going live, yeah? This is a live stream to all the people, them. Guys, I'm at my grandma's house. I'm with my grandma. Wave, Grandma. I got her.
I'm still shaking.
Oh, look, Adette. This is my friend Adette. I danced with her. I'll show you some videos, or I've danced with her. Hi, Grandma. We love you. See, Grandma, they love you.
Thank you very much.
They love
Thank
you, Grandma.
You.
I'm gonna cry.
Maybe one day I might be well enough to come up to London and see everybody.
Love of my life, yeah, love of my life. If you guys respect anything that I do on social media, this is where my confidence came from. Happy birthday, Grandma, we love you. Big up the OG, big up the old Grandma. More life to Grandma. Pew pew. Happy birthday, Grandma. See, Grandma,
thank you.
They love you so much.
Yeah, I know. And I love you as well, my love. Thank you, everybody. Oh. Perhaps one day we'll meet, hopefully.
Yeah. Oh, my God. I love you. See you, Grandma.
Don't make me cry.
Baddest fucking bee on this planet.
Well, talk about surprises. I've had nearly everybody here today. Last night, I got a call from this one. I'm on my way home, I'm on the train, she says. There's a parcel coming for you. Make sure you're in between 9 and 10. 9:30. I said, oh, it's a bit late for somebody to come, isn't it? It wasn't, it was here. Yeah, it's here.
Yeah, I said, I'm the gift, I'm the parcel.
Birthday to you. Happy birthday. Mom. Happy birthday to you.
Looks like 16.
Yeah. It does, doesn't it?
16.
Yeah, not 17, 16.
How did you bring that down? down.
No, we didn't.
You did? Yeah. Oh, I'm out of coffee. Oh, thank you.
All for you, Ben. So,
yeah, but I can't eat it.
You can have a small...
Well, it's only sponge in there, because Chloe and these two are like this while we're on Tesco. No.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, but I'll have a very small bit.
Yeah.
Home time.
Bye, my darling. I love you very much.
Oh.
And I wish you luck with everything you do.
Oh.
I've been thinking about you.
Oh, my babes.
I love you, Grandma. I miss you so much. Make those videos with your parents, your families, your loved ones. Because my grandma's gone and I miss her dearly. But I cannot tell you the joy that came to my soul watching back this video. So, yeah, that's just a little... word to the wise. If you feel like you got to know me more, that's great. If you didn't, it's okay. Because you know what you can do? You can just watch the next video. It's cool, babe. I got you. We're getting to know each other. It's a relationship, you know? Don't be afraid. Don't be shy. Subscribe as well. Hit the subscribe button. Huh?